Today, I'd like to offer you a solution on how to possibly get rid of the notion of time, the illusion of time. And with the illusion of time goes the illusion of motion and also the illusions of birth and death. And therefore, let's talk about that because even biological age is frequently referred to as the metabolism of time. I have frequently quoted the Vedanta as saying time is the consumer and we are its food. We consume the notion of time into the notion of aging and then the notion of death. So right off the bat, let's talk about something that goes back over 300 years BC, something called Zeno's arrow paradox. It's one of a number of paradoxes formulated by the Greek philosopher Zeno of Elea. And the paradox states that for motion to occur, an object's must change the position which it occupies. However, at any one durationless instant of time, an object is neither moving to where it is nor to where it is not. Once again, at any one durationless instant of time, an object is neither moving to where it is, nor to where it is not. It cannot move to where it is not because no time elapses for it to move there. It cannot move to where it is because it is already there. In other words, at any instant of time, there is no motion occurring. If everything is motionless at every instant and time is entirely composed of instants, then motion is impossible. And therefore, actually, both motion and time are illusions. Just for a second, recapitulate that. Imagine an arrow in flight. At any given instant of time, the arrow is at rest at a particular point in space. Therefore, at any given instant of time, the arrow is not moving. If the arrow is not moving at any instant of time, at any given instant of time, then it cannot be moving at all. Therefore, motion is impossible. And if motion is impossible, then time is impossible. So all these conundrums actually can be understood in modern physics as laws of thermodynamics and motion and time linked in a fundamental way, motion being defined as a change in position over time. That means that we cannot measure motion without measuring time. Okay, so that all is pretty well accepted. But have you heard of the quantum Zeno effect? So let me share with you what the quantum Zeno effect is. The quantum Zeno effect is a phenomenon in quantum mechanics whereby the frequent measurement of a quantum system suppresses the evolution of the system. In other words, if a quantum system is in superposition of states, measuring it repeatedly will make it more likely to stay in its current state. Okay, so let's carry the quantum Zeno effect to its extreme. So if the quantum Zeno effect is a phenomenon in quantum mechanics in which time evolution of a quantum system can be slowed down or even completely halted by making frequent measurements of the system. So if you make frequent measurements of the system, you can almost completely halt the evolution of that quantum system. This is because each measurement causes the wave function of the system to collapse, and if the measurements are made frequently enough, the wave function will not have time to evolve between measurements. In theory, it is possible to use the quantum Zeno effect to prevent a quantum system from decaying. For example, if a radioactive atom is observed continuously, it will never decay. Okay. However, in practice, it is difficult to make continuous measurement of a quantum system without disturbing the system itself. Okay. So theoretically, if a quantum system is observed continuously, it will not decay. Okay, so theoretically, based on the quantum Zeno effect, very well documented, it is possible to both stop the decay and therefore the evolution of time in this theoretical framework. The quantum Zeno effect has been observed in a number of experiments, including experiments, atoms, photons, and electrons. So how do we solve this dilemma? Well, you know, if you look at Einstein's theories of relativity, both general theory of relativity and the special theory of relativity, they both have to do with the position of the observer, the movement of the observer. In the special theory of relativity, if the observer is riding a beam of light, or is riding a beam of light, therefore, at the speed of light, time will cease to exist for that observer. Similarly, in the grand theory of relativity, if you're getting close to a black hole, and as you get to the event horizon, time slows down, even stops. Okay, but in all these theories, the observer is thought to be a human body bind with instruments, let's say, extensions, but the observer is still a human body mind. I think this is where the flaw is. The observer is never the human body mind, because the human body mind is also an observed object. I can observe my body and my mind, my thoughts. So they're objects of observation. And you can observe your own thoughts and your body and your mind. So they're objects of observation. And you, the body mind, as an object, and that which you observe, whatever, the quantum, so-called, are actually both objects of observation. The body-mind is an object of observation, and the quantum particle is an object of observation. And they're both entangled in the only observer there is, which is non-local. And if that observer actually is understood as beyond subject-object split, then quantum Zeno effect makes sense. The observer and the observed are non-locally entangled, and when they fuse, there is no motion and there is no time. Okay, there's no motion and there is no time. Now think about this. Have you ever experienced a moment that is not now? It is not possible to get out of the now, because the now never ends, and therefore it's not a moment in time. What is now? Now is the absence of subject-object split. Therefore, now is timeless. And dharana, focused awareness in yoga, and ultimately samadhi, where there's complete absence of subject-object split, is timeless. Our fundamental reality as non-local beings that are the only subject of experience, in which both body-mind and that which is observed, body-mind and everything that's observed, trees, stars, rocks, all of them are entangled as one unified knowing. And in that unified knowing, there is no time. We create the subjective experience of time by actually moving out of the timeless now. We think of the past, So we don't experience the past, we only experience the thought of the past. We think of the future, we don't experience the future, we only experience the thought of the future. So experientially, we are never in what is called not now. We are never out of now. And now is timeless. And now is the same thing as you, the non-local you, is always now. And in that non-local being, which is infinite and timeless, what we see as the movement of time is a perceptual artifact, a very clever trick through subject-object split. Such is the illusion of time. We can never get out of now, because now is not in time. So now is eternal. And now is not subject to birth and death. But we can create mental constructs of time through memory, a thought about the past, not the actual past, a thought about the future, not the actual future. The actual experience is always now, and therefore timeless, and therefore eternal, and therefore not subject to birth and death. And you are that timeless now. You are that. Now, just think of a program on television. You know, you're this character, look at my finger, it's moving from here to here, okay, and back and forth. But actually, at the level electrons and photons, all that's going on is photons and electrons are appearing and disappearing in a particular pattern that creates the illusion of movement. And because we're embedded in the illusion of movement, we get embedded in the illusion of time. But just like movement on this screen of your computer is actually an illusion. There's only electrons and photons bubbling in and out and changing patterns that give us both the illusion of movement and therefore the illusion of time. I hope you are understanding this. So what's the point of all this? By shifting our experience of time, we can shift our experience of what we call age. We can consume less of the illusion of time. This is the real secret to slowing down the aging process and even stopping it for a while. But just like it is impossible to do a quantum experiment without disturbing the system, and also technically it's not feasible to do non-interrupted measurement, you know, stall the measurement, so too samadhi is a process that one has to learn, where the object of experience and that which is supposedly the subject of experience fuse, but in reality they were both entangled objects of experience. So reflect on this, because this is the secret to timeless being and subjective immortality. It's a shift in allegiance from the person as body-mind to the awareness in which person as body-mind and the objects associated with that body-mind are entangled in an ecosystem of observers, modes of knowing, and objects observed, when in reality there's only the modes of knowing that give us experiences, different experiences of space-time and causality. So there's no conflict between general relativity and quantum mechanics if you think of both those theories as emerging from different modes of knowing in consciousness. Ultimately, only consciousness creates all these illusions, and they're real experiences, so it doesn't matter if we call them illusions or reality, because we're embedded in them. But once we untangle all these illusions, then we recognize that the true self is timeless and immortal. Let me know your thoughts.